bulletin, we will be having a different way of having the LFCS home Christmas tour this year. It will be done virtually. And if you wish to participate, there is information in your newsletter. You go online, order your ticket, and then they'll send you the information of how to link into that. It's going to be held on the 12th of December. Also, we're hopeful that we will be getting some information about a family that we can adopt to provide some Christmas gifts, as we have done in the past. Didn't have that information yet, but I hope to have it by Wednesday evening, and then again, it'll be here Sunday. So look forward to that. We continue then. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, as we begin the season of Advent, let this brief remind us that Jesus Christ came to conquer the darkness of sin and to lead us into the light of his glorious kingdom. As the prophet Isaiah says, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in the land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. Please pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, the true light, who came into the world to enlighten everyone, bless us as we light the candles of this wreath in preparation for your coming, and so enkindle our hearts with the fire of your love, that we may receive you with joy and gladness, and evermore remain steadfast in the faith, who live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Lord Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless this wreath for youth in his church throughout this holy season of Advent. Amen. The delightful and traditional custom of lighting candles in a symbolic countdown begins this first Sunday in Advent. No universally accepted ideas have been assigned to each of the candles on our Advent wreath. This fact permits us the Christian freedom to assign our own ideas to these candles. This year, we will focus on imitating the faith seen in the saints, whom we will consider this Advent season. Those themes are hold the faith, show the faith, witness to the faith, and encourage the faith. The first candle serves to encourage us to hold to the faith. In our Advent pilgrimage, we are reminded that once again the long-expected one stands at our door. He is our strength and consolation, our hope and joy, the desire of every nation. In one of the gospel readings at the end of the church year, we hear Jesus warn us, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name claiming, I am he, and will deceive many." Likewise, in today's gospel reading, Jesus urges, "Therefore keep watch, because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone, watch." Let us therefore hold to the faith. We do this in part by keeping watch, by preparing our hearts and our homes to greet our Lord Emmanuel. To enable us to be watchful, let us pray with boldness and certainty, O come, Emmanuel. The truth of our Lord's coming motivate us to declare confidently, Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. invite you to please stand as we pray together. Holy Spirit, you have called us by the gospel and enlightened us with your gifts. We ask now that you would sanctify and keep us in the true way. Only as you keep us in the true way are we ready to celebrate the coming of our Savior, to receive the benefits of his death and resurrection, and to meet our Savior on the last day. Keep us constantly watchful and alert as you nurture us by means of your word and sacraments. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who reigns with the Father in you now and forever. Amen. If you, O Lord, kept the record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? We are gathered to hear God's word and call upon him in prayer and praise. Let us first consider our unworthiness.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we confess before you and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together, we take refuge in your infinite mercy, seeking your grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for you and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We continue with the Kyrie.
Thank you.
Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for the first Sunday in Advent, and also this day we're focusing upon God's servant Noah, is recorded in the book of Genesis, chapter 7. The Lord then said to Noah, "Go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I have found you righteous in this generation. Take with you 7 pairs of every kind of clean animal, a male and its mate, and 1 pair of every kind of unclean animal, a male and its mate, and also 7 pairs of every kind of bird, male and female, to keep their various kinds alive throughout the earth. 7 days from now, I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and I will wipe from the face of the earth every living creature I have made." And Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. In the 600th year of Noah's life, on the 17th day of the 2nd month, on that day all the springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heavens were opened, and rain fell on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. For 40 days the flood kept coming on the earth, and as the waters increased, they lifted the ark high above the earth. The waters rose and increased greatly on the earth, and the ark floated on the surface of the water. They rose greatly on the earth, and all the high mountains under the entire heavens were covered. The waters rose and covered the mountains to a depth of more than 20 feet. Every living thing that moved on the earth perished. Birds, livestock, wild animals, all the creatures that swarm over the earth, and all mankind. Everything on dry land that had the breath of life in its nostrils died. Every living thing on the face of the earth was wiped out. Men and animals, and the creatures that move along the ground, and the birds were wiped from the earth. Only Noah was left, and those with him in the ark. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is recorded in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 1. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. For in him you have been enriched in every way, in all your speaking and in all your knowledge, because our testimony about Christ was confirmed in you. Therefore, you do not lack any spiritual gift, as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will keep you strong to the end, so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, is faithful. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Join in singing the gospel acclamation. Please stand. That time men will see the Son of Man you know that it is near, right at the door. I tell you the truth, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Earth and heaven will pass away, but my words will never pass away. No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Be alert. You do not know when that time will come. It's like a man going away. He leaves his house and puts his servants in charge, each with his assigned task, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening, or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone, watch. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We join to make confession of our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We continue with our hymn, which is entitled Noah Worked Upon the Ark. You will not find this in the Lutheran service book. Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, our Advent King, there are people today, even Christians, who will say, Christians shouldn't be so heavenly minded because it makes them of no earthly good. I've never completely understood or agreed with this thought, because if you really understand the victory of eternal life in Jesus, if you really believe in the promise of his holiness, peace, and eternal salvation now and to come forever, if you really understand the fullness of what is to come on the final day of our Lord, it changes how you live now. C.S. Lewis went even further. It is, since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world, that they have become so ineffective in this one. So many of us are caught up in what we call that rat race of life, struggling to make ends meet, struggling to keep families together, struggling just to make it through the day. We forget the key to all of life is our relationship with God. By grace, through faith, now and forever. The day of our Lord's return and the glories of his kingdom empower us in the mundane challenges of this life. The awesomeness of eternal life in him strengthens us to take on the challenge of day-to-day living. Sometimes it's the looking ahead that gives us the strength to deal with our past and our present tasks. Robbie Robbins was an Air Force pilot during the first Iraq War. After his 300th mission, he was surprised to be given permission to immediately pull all his group together and fly home. They flew across the ocean to Massachusetts and then had a long drive to western Pennsylvania. They drove all night, and when his buddies dropped him off at his driveway, just after sunup, here was this huge banner across the garage. Welcome home, Dad. How did they know? No one had called. Even the crew hadn't expected to leave so quickly. Robin relates, when I walked into the house, the kids, half-dressed for school, screamed, Daddy! Susan came running down the hall. She looked terrific. Hair done, makeup, and a crisp yellow dress. How did you know, I asked. I didn't, she answered through tears of joy. We knew you'd try to surprise us, so we were ready every day. If you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior by faith, then you're waiting for the return of the one who lived, died, and rose again for you. Today, we begin the Advent season and a new church year. The word Advent means coming or arrival. Jesus is coming. His final coming is just around the corner, and that's part of our focus during the Advent season. The Advent season is 4 weeks, which is why we have 4 candles on our Advent wreath. Each week we light another candle as we progress through Advent until we reach Christmas, when we celebrate Jesus' first arrival as a baby in Bethlehem. As we focus on his final coming, instead of coming as baby, Jesus will be coming as a powerful, divine, glorious King.
That's why the Advent color is blue, a color of royalty and of heaven. This morning, I want you to ask yourself, am I getting ready for that unexpected day when Jesus returns? Or am I procrastinating? Am I holding to the faith? Or am I thinking I have plenty of time? In our text, Jesus tells us to keep watch and get ready. Many people won't be ready. In the evangelist Matthew's account of this conversation that Jesus is having, Jesus compares the world on Judgment Day to the coming of the flood in Noah's day. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. This is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. What was wrong with these people at the time of the flood? They weren't ready. They had no relationship with God. Their entire lives revolved around themselves and the things of this earth and nothing else. I'm sure they all knew about Noah, this man who was building a boat in the desert. But they ignored this. They ignored having any real type of relationship with God. And then the flood came and took them all away. Noah, in contrast, held on to the faith. Even though he likely had questions and perhaps doubts along the way. Moses records, Noah was a righteous man, blameless, among the people of his time, and he walked with God. God was troubled, deeply troubled, with what he saw happening in the world. He shared his intention of putting an end to all people with Noah and instructed him to build an ark. Then Moses declares, Noah did everything just as God commanded him. Imagine yourself in Noah's place. Would you have trusted God when he told you he was going to destroy the world and wanted you to build an ark in order to save yourself and your family? Could you have endured the ridicule of those onlookers as he was laboring over the building of the ark? Are you holding on to the faith when it's becoming more and more challenging to stand up for God and his word in our present time and culture? Are you preparing for the day of our Lord's final advent, his final coming? Or are you procrastinating? A spiritual procrastinator is someone who's not ready. This person says, eventually I'll get my act together spiritually, but not right now. I've got too much going on. The story is told of three apprentice devils who were speaking with Satan about their plans to destroy humankind. The first apprentice suggested they would succeed if they told the people there were no God. Satan rejected this suggestion because he realized more people know there is a God and wouldn't be convinced about others. The second apprentice suggested telling people there's no hell. But Satan rejected this idea because he knew too many people knew there is a hell. The third apprentice devil suggested, let's destroy all humanity by telling them there's no word. Satan loved this suggestion because he knew people would procrastinate.
it's too late. We can't get our act together on Judgment Day. Time has run out. How important, then, that we hold fast to the faith. We pray to our Savior. We repent and rejoice that Jesus forgives us. He forgives us for all our lack of watchfulness and alertness. That's why Jesus was born on Christmas so many years ago. His whole purpose was to take away our sin. He did this by living a life that perfectly glorified God. And then he gives us the credit. He took all of our shortcomings, all our spiritual procrastination, all of our sins on himself and paid for them by dying on the cross. He rose then from the dead to prove to us we truly are forgiven. We are really going to rise from the dead, and then we'll glorify God in that life to come. You are a child of God, a modern-day Noah, because of your washing in holy baptism. Because of Jesus and his sacrifice of his life for you, you will be with him on that last day. Until that day, Jesus urges, be on guard, be alert. You do not know when that time will come. Preparing for Jesus means making Jesus the priority in our lives. You do what you normally do, but Jesus is number one. Your relationship with him isn't down there at the bottom of your list, but it's there at the top. Worship with other Christians. Join in Bible study with other Christians and on your own. This is number one. Your relationship with Jesus is number one in your life. That's what it means to be watchful, to be ready, to hold to the faith. Such a person is a modern-day Noah, someone who has a real and growing relationship with God. What's our motivation? Not fear of punishment. Because Jesus took all of our punishment away when he died for us on the cross. We're forgiven children of God. So our motivation is the joy and hope that we have in God our Savior, and the anticipation of being with him for eternity. May this Advent season be a joyful time, a hopeful time. We rejoice now that Jesus came on Christmas. We also look forward to rejoicing then, when Jesus will come unexpectedly on Judgment Day. Lord, give me the heart of Noah, a heart that's ready and focused on you. Amen. Now may the peace and love of our God that passes beyond all understanding guard and protect your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Savior. Amen. We continue with our hymn of response, which is entitled, The Advent Season Calls Us. Again, you will not find this one in the hymn.
Thank you.
us pray for the whole church in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Please stand. Eternal and gracious Father, we give you thanks for bringing us to the end of one church year and to the beginning of another. As you have kept us in the days of the past, so do we pray you would keep us in the days to come. Enrich your saints in every way as we enter another church year. Teach us to be faithful in all things, grateful for all your gifts, urgent in your word, and hopeful for our Lord's coming again. We claim nothing as our own, for all things come from you, except the worship of our lips, the service of our lives, and the tithes and offerings we bring in Jesus' name. Guide us to use all things for your glory, for the blessing of those in our care, and for the support of your church. O Lord, as we wait for your appearing, enable us to hold to the faith to the end. Eternal and gracious Father, encourage the preachers of your word and all who hear, that the testimony about Jesus our Savior may be confirmed again among us. Give boldness and faithfulness to Synodical President Harrison, District President Hagen, our circuit visitors, and all pastors in Christ. As you have called us into the fellowship of your Son, so sustain us as we wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus. Do not let us be ashamed of our hope, but come quickly. Sustain us by your Holy Spirit, that we may have joy at the advent of our Savior. We long for an end to the struggles of this mortal life, and for the start of everlasting life with Jesus and all the saints in your presence forevermore. Keep us from becoming contented with this life and from despair over the burdens of the flesh. We pray ever more earnestly to see your face and to know in full the joy of your presence. O Lord, as we wait for your appearing, enable us to hold to the faith to the end. Eternal and gracious Father, preserve and bless all Christian households, that husbands and wives would live in love and service to each other, that fathers and mothers would diligently bring up their children in your fear, and that children would honor their parents and be well equipped for service to their neighbors in this life. We praise and thank you for your tender mercies, which you have shown us throughout our days, including to Randy and Vicky as they celebrate their anniversary. Open our eyes to see the many blessings that come from your hand of mercy, so we may continually return thanks to you, the giver of all good gifts. O Lord, as we wait for your appearing, enable us to hold to the faith to the end. Eternal and gracious Father, be with the governing authorities and enable them to preserve peace and order in our nations. Hear our prayers for President Trump, Governor Carson, our military and police, and other civil servants, as well as all newly elected officials. Increase the spirit of unity and cooperation among the people of our land and the nations of the world. Establish your peace among the nations, and bring to nothing the plots of those who delight in evil, terror, and violence. O Lord, as we wait for your appearing, enable us to hold to the faith to the end. Eternal and gracious Father, behold in mercy all who are in any danger, trouble, sickness, or need. Hear our prayers for the sick and suffering, including Clara, John, Gladys, Brad, Reverend Larry Brock, Danny, Glenn, Claude, Lily, Emma, Gary, Sherry, Kathy, Stephen, Bonnie, Sherry, David, Helen, Jimmy, Paisley, Rhonda, Bill, Freeman, Shirley, Ken, Reverend Torreson, Ron, Larry, all who are still dealing with recovery from the effects of violence and natural disasters, all affected by
safe and staff safe in our schools, that in-person instruction may continue. Give health to our world and bring the pandemic to an end. Comfort all who mourn and sustain them with a confident hope in the resurrection. O Lord, as we wait for your appearing, enable us to hold to the faith to the end. Eternal and gracious Father, you have given all judgment to your Son, whose words will not pass away. Grant that your people may hold fast to the words of your Son suffered, and that no human thing he may obscure his testament, by which the true body and blood of Christ are eaten for the forgiveness of sins. Sustain us in repentance and saving faith, united in a true confession, and always awake, watching for your return. O Lord, as we wait for your appearing, enable us to hold to the faith to the end. Eternal and gracious Father, we pray not as we ought, but as we are able, trusting in your mercy to supply us with all things needful and beneficial. Keep far from us all things harmful, that we may be kept holy and blameless to the day of Jesus coming, as we pray in his name. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.